πρωί μέχρι τις 2 η ώρα, ναι. Και μετά τις θα τελειώσουμε. Το βράδυ. Περίμενα ότι θα έρθουν και δύο ξένοι, αλλά ο ένας έχει φύγει, ο Ολλανδός έχει φύγει. Και ο Αλεχάνδρος
έχει φύγει.
Γεια σας. Κάνουμε μια χαμηλή ώρα.
Μάλλον το background της ομιλίας μου βασίστηκε κυρίως σε αυτό το βιβλίο, το οποίο ονομάζεται Tactical Decisions, το οποίο για αυτούς που ενδιαφέρονται το ζήτημα προσφέρει μια πολύ ωραία εισαγωγή και είναι εύκολο διάβαστο σχετικά με άλλα βιβλία της εποχής του 50-60, ξέρω εγώ. Οπότε το συνιστώ. Θα μιλήσω εγώ βασικά για 2-3 πράγματα. Πρώτον, πρέπει να αναθεωρήσουμε λίγο. Θα μιλήσουμε για την πιθανότητα. Το πρώτο πράγμα που θα μιλήσω είναι τι πιστεύει ο καθένας από εμάς, πώς θέλουν να αποφάσεις. Τι πιστεύει ο καθένας μας, τι σημαίνει να πιστεύω σε κάτι. Πώς μπορεί να αλλάξει αυτό που μπορεί να πιστεύω και πώς μπορεί να χρησιμοποιήσει αυτό που πιστεύω για να πάρω αποφάσεις. Δηλαδή, άμα πιστεύω ότι Μπορεί να κερδίσουν το λαχείο, μπορεί να αγοράσουν ένα λαχείο. Για πάμε.
Ένα τρόπο να παρασκήσουμε το τι θέλει ο καθένας είναι να χρησιμοποιήσουμε πιθανότητα. Μπορούμε να πούμε, ας πούμε, ότι υπάρχει ένα set.
Πιο περίπλοκο, γιατί όταν παίρνεις μια απόφαση,
θα πρέπει επίσης να βλέπεις και να έχεις κάποιο τρόπο να δεις τι σου θέλει το πιθανό κέρδος με τις απόφασεις, ανάλογα με το τι σκέφτεσαι τώρα. Για παράδειγμα, αν θέλω να πάρω ένα στοίχημα με κάποιον που έχει ένα νόμισμα και μου λέει, κοίτα, θα σου δώσω άμα έρθει το κεφάλι του νόμισμα, το θέλω να πάρω και το κορώνα. Αν έρθει το κορώνα το νόμισμα, τότε θα κερδίσει το στοίχημα, αλλά το χάσει. Εσύ τώρα έχεις την επιλογή να παίξεις ή να μην παίξεις. Άμα ξέρεις τις πιθανότητες να έχει το νόμισμα κεφάλι ή κορώνα γράμματα, τότε άμα έχεις την επιθυμία, τότε παίξεις δεν παίξεις το δύο είναι. Άμα ξέρεις ότι υπάρχει μια πιθανότητα παραπάνω να έρθει η κορώνα από πράγμα, θα σταματήσει η κορώνα συγκεκριμένα. Αλλιώ δεν έχει σημασία.
Λοιπόν, τώρα θα το κάνουμε λίγο πιο ακριβές αυτό. Παίρνοντας λοιπόν με το νόμισμα, και βλέπω, άμα πάρουμε μερικές παρατηρήσεις, τότε θα αλλάξει η ιδέα μας για το πώς είναι το νόμισμα. Δηλαδή, μπορεί αρχικά να πιστεύουμε ότι μάλλον το νόμισμα είναι ακέραιο και συνέχεια με 50% πιθανότητα κορώνα γράμματα. Αλλά καθώς παίζουμε, μπορεί να πέφτει όλο συνέχεια κεφάλι κορώνα. Τότε τι σημαίνει αυτό. Σημαίνει ότι το νόμισμα είναι πειραγμένο, μήπως απλά είναι τυχαίο αυτό. Θα πρέπει να συνεχίσουμε να παίζουμε, μήπως θα πρέπει να σταματήσουμε. Το πρόβλημα λοιπόν γίνεται πλέον δύσκολο, γιατί πρέπει να λάβουμε υπόψη για το πώς θα αλλάζει ο τρόπος σκέψης μας με τις παρατηρήσεις που θα παίρνουμε. Λοιπόν, θα ξεκινήσουμε λοιπόν. Καταρχήν, θα μιλήσω πάλι για την πιθανότητα. Στην κλασική πιθανότητα, έχουμε ένα set πιθανότητα, ένα set outcomes. Ελέγχω. Αποτελεσμάτων. Τέλος πάντων, έχουμε ένα set αποτελεσμάτων από τέτοια πειράματα. Τώρα, ας πούμε, το νόμισμα που λέγαμε δεν είναι ακριβώς τυχαίο πειράμα, γιατί ουσιαστικά είναι το σύστημα deterministic. Και το ρίσκο νόμισμα, ανάλογα με τη φυσική, θα έρθει κάπως. Ένα άλλο κλασικό random παράδειγμα είναι αυτό με τα two slits που κάνουμε στα quantum physics. Που έχει ένα φωτόνιο, περνάει από δύο slits, αλλά δεν ξέρει τι θα περάσει. Είναι πιθανότητα να περάσει από ένα slit 50% και είναι πιθανότητα να περάσει το άλλο άλλα 50%. Και όταν κάνει τη μέτρηση, βλέπει που έχει περάσει. Λοιπόν, οπότε σε αυτή την περίπτωση, η πιθανότητα αυτή είναι απλά πιθανότητα του τυχαίου γεγονότος. Στην θεωρία των πιθανότητων. Το subjective probability, στην υποκειμενική πιθανότητα λοιπόν, έχουμε πάλι ακριβώς την ίδια μαθηματική σχέση. Έχουμε πάλι πιθανότητες, ακριβώς όλα τα ίδια πράγματα ισχύουν. Αλλά η διαφορά που υπάρχει είναι ότι η πιθανότητα δεν εκφράζει κάποιο τυχαίο γεγονός. Εκφράζει την πραγματικότητα. Τι πιστεύουμε εμείς ότι είναι πραγματικότητα. Πιστεύω ότι το νόμισμα το οποίο ρίχνουμε είναι ακέραιο και είναι 50-50 ή πιστεύω ότι έχει κάποιο άλλο distribution.
Ένα ωραίο παράδειγμα, α πούμε, το νόμισμα είναι ωραίο παράδειγμα για την είναι να πεις ότι αυτός ο άξονας είναι η πιθανότητα το νόμισμα να έχει χέρι. Και τι έχουμε να πάξουμε εδώ πέρα, το πέρα, πει όλη τη φράση τι πιστεύουμε για το νόμισμα. Πιστεύουμε ότι τα χρυσά νομίσματα περίπου πρέπει να είναι 100 ευρώ. Αλλά κάποια νομίσματα μπορεί να μην είναι παράνομα, δεν είναι σωστά, και να είναι το ίδιο το λίγο λίγο. Αλλά σε κανένα νομίσμα θα έχει συνέχεια και έχει συνέχεια τέλει.
Οπότε σε αυτή την περίπτωση,
το experiment, το εξήγημα να κάνουμε experiment, πηγαίνει στην κοινή ρωτά που έχουμε μέσα και πιθανότητα το νόμιμο έφτυγε και επίσης έχουμε την πιθανότητα να έχει κάποιες συγκεκριμένες περιπτώσεις και ρωτά που γίνουν τα.
Τώρα το καλό με τη δεύτερη αντίληψη της πιθανότητας είναι ότι αποκτά και ένα επιπλέον νόημα το κοντήσουμε probability, η δεσμευμένη πιθανότητα. Μπορείς να χρησιμοποιήσεις τη δεσμευμένη πιθανότητα για να αλλάζεις τον τρόπο σκέψης σου. Φέρνοντας καινούργια δεδομένα, μπορείς να κάνεις conditioning, το distribution του τι είναι πιθανό, πάνω στα καινούργια σου δεδομένα. Οπότε να κάνεις, να αυξάνεις την επιβεβαιότητά σου ότι ισχύει. Οπότε μπορεί να ξεκινήσεις εσύ ότι το νόημα είναι έτσι, αλλά παραδοτώντας ένα εκατομμύριο outcomes του πειράματος, το τέλος θα φτάσει σε ένα άλλο distribution για το τι είναι πραγματικότητα, που μπορεί να είναι έτσι. Ένας και εγώ σίγουρος πλέον το νόημα είναι fair, είναι 50-50. Ή μπορεί και να καταλήξει, άμα κάνει ένα εκατομμύριο γράμματα και έχει συνέχεια και, ακόμα και να έχει πολύ μικρή πιθανότητα ότι είναι και το νόμισμα, το τέλος μπορεί να καταλήξει. Σε αυτή την περίπτωση, το νόμισμά σου είναι μάλλον έχει κάποιο πρόβλημα. Κάποιο το πειράζει. Αυτό λοιπόν μπορούμε να το γράψουμε έτσι. Έχουμε τα πιθανά μοντέλα έτσι, κάθε μοντέλο είναι ένα μοντέλο του κόσμου. Οπότε ουσιαστικά το κάθε μοντέλο αντιστοιχεί σε ένα probability distribution για το τι συμβαίνει στον κόσμο. Συγκεκριμένα για το νόμο και το παράδειγμα του νόσμου, κάθε συγκεκριμένο hypothesis αντιστοιχεί σε την πιθανότητα να έρθει το νόμισμα χέρι τέλη. Τώρα μπορούμε να παρακολουθήσουμε το τι πιστεύουμε με ένα distribution πάλι. Ας το λέμε γενικά αυτό το log C, το πιστεύουμε, και μπορούμε να χρησιμοποιήσουμε κάποιες παρατηρήσεις, πες ένα εκατομμύριο παρατηρήσεις από το νόμισμα, για να μπορέσουμε να καταλάβουμε να εξάγουμε μια νέα αντίληψη. Για να εξάγουμε την νέα αντίληψη, χρησιμοποιούμε απλά τον ορισμό του conditional distribution. Και προτείνουμε τα εξής. Έχουμε εδώ, είναι τι λέει με το belief που έχουμε τώρα για το κάθε μοντέλο, τι λέει το συγκεκριμένο μοντέλο για τα δεδομένα που θα παρατηρήσουμε. Δηλαδή, αν παρατηρήσουμε, αν έχουμε ένα μοντέλο που λέει το νόμιμο μέχρι συνέχεια και πατήσουμε κάποια τέλη, τότε η πιθανότητα να πατήσουμε αυτό το πράγμα είναι μηδενική το μοντέλο. Αν έχουμε ένα μοντέλο το οποίο λέει το νόμισμα είναι 0,5% κάτι, 0,5% μπορεί να είναι και τέλη, τότε και να πατήσουμε 100 και τη συνέχεια, αυτό είναι μια πιθανότητα να πατήσουμε 50 ή τίποτα άλλο. Και λοιπόν, χρησιμοποιώντα αυτό εδώ πέρα, μπορούμε να πάρουμε ένα νέο distribution πάνω στα όλα τα πιθανά μοντέλα, το οποίο λέγεται posterior belief, posterior distribution. Των υστέρων πιθανότητα. Ναι.
Okay, so I can continue in English for the moment. So let's say now we have a distribution, a theory distribution, and we want to do something with it, right? What can we do with it? Well, we can use it to predict what's going to happen in the future. So after we have a particular distribution, I say, okay, we just choose the point so after we have a specific distribution over all the models, you can say okay, we just care about the model with the highest probability, we ignore everything else. And that's called maximum posteriori inference. And then we can use this model to predict. The other way to do it is to use Bayesian inference. Or averaging over all the possible models, because you know this model may have a high probability also that this one and this one and well this one is going to be much lower than the other one. So what we can do is just integrate over the whole set of models. In practice, this can be very hard. So apart from some very special distributions, so what some other people do is to use Monte Carlo inference, where you actually just take samples from this distribution if you can, and you average over them equally. But
not very interesting now.
What else can we do with models? Well, if we do have this coin experiment, let's say that we have decided that the coin is probably distributed this way, so probably it's coming heads more of the time. Okay? So what we want to do is to, or if we gamble with somebody and this guy says, okay, just bet what we want to take heads, and we'll come, if we believe that this is the distribution, then we can always bet heads, and we are sure to win something. So in the utility theory, you basically, for each one outcomes, an experiment, you have, this is a particular reward. In this case, just a monetary reward, you can just say that the amount of money you get is your reward. So for each outcome, you have a reward. And the expected reward for outcomes is just the probability of every outcome, that degraded over its reward. So interesting case is when you condition these probabilities on the actions. So the actions were whether to bet head or tails, for example. So if you use your belief and you bet heads, then as soon as you observe that then you really get more heads, so the utility of betting for heads is higher than the utility of betting for tails, because you believe that probability is much higher one over the other. So this, again, taking the expectation of all the rewards, condition on all the choices that you have, gives you the utility of every choice. This is basically the expectation of the reward for every possible choice. Okay. So if this is not clear now, you can tell me something, and otherwise, yeah, it can be harder to continue. Okay. So I try it again. So what does it mean actually? Well, it means if R is a random variable, the reward, then given our possibility, given a particular model, let's say this model, then this gives a probability of the outcomes. And given a particular action, we get a different outcome of losing the bet or winning the bet. And this is the expected gain that we get after we make this bet. If we have uncertainty, then we have to integrate over all the models again. So it's exactly the same thing as before. Only now, instead of having here the probability of every event happening, we have just the expectation of the reward. So it's exactly the same Bayesian framework as before. And there are other ways to do this decision-making under uncertainty, because in the worst case, for example, you say, hey, oh, whatever I bet this guy will always somehow make the coin come heads. If I bet heads, it will always make it come heads, and if I bet heads, always will become tails. This is not statistical, right? Because adversarial. You have an adversary that somehow always cheats and makes a coin turn the other way around. Okay, so it's different. Minimax regret is something else. It's basically whenever you make a decision and one of these hypotheses turns out to be true, it tells you what you would have gained compared to what you have chosen now if this word was true. But this could come sometimes be output in this framework, but usually not.
Usually, up to a point, you can put them in this framework, but especially the adversarial context where you have somebody that is actually actively trying to work against you, you cannot really use that unless you have also a belief about how this person is behaving. So that's much more complicated. But, yeah.
So far we have only looked at how to take a single decision. When you have multiple decisions, you have questions.
In the case of the coin,
yeah.
If you have an adversary, mm-hmm. What do you model? You model the distribution of the coin, or do you model the decisions of the adversary?
You have to model the decisions of the adversary. And if you usually cannot even model them, unless you say there is a thing, there's a set of values that you can follow, you can try and find astrology.
So the problem with modeling the coin, what it is, that the distribution changes?
Without the adversary, the problem is you don't know
what it is. Without the adversary, it's clear.
say we make this problem slightly more difficult. Let's say that we want to bet on horses, okay? And every time, there is a race for the horses, you observe how the two, and you can have an estimate of how good each horse is. So you can have a fixed amount of pocket money to spend on horses every week, and then you can split as you want among the horses, maybe so that to maximize your profits. Okay, but the thing is that you always get new knowledge about the horses, whether you bet on them or not. Okay. This is the important part. The more difficult part is something like the coin problem, not with an adversary, but with somebody that tells you that I'm accepting bets. In that case, you have to take into account the fact that whenever you make a bet, you will observe something new about the coin, so you get more information. So two ways of looking at this one is, the first one, the classic Aristotelian problem, is you want to make a decision about, let's say, whether to buy 100,000 cans of tomatoes from a particular supplier. So what you do is, you start sampling some of these kinds of tomatoes. You can just sample 100 and say, if manufacturer of Maribu, I will buy this 100,000 cans. Otherwise, you can say, wait, what will happen? Just pick 100. Maybe just buy one, look at it, take another one. And as soon as you have five that are bad, that means that the manufacturing is already, condition is already not satisfied, so stop. So this area is stopping. And in general, you can write all these problems as some way of maximizing future rewards. So instead of maximizing one reward, or the utility function will be expressed as a sum of all future rewards, maybe weighted in some way, but still sum. So there are two things. First of all, what we do now in this sequential framework may affect what we see later. So we want to do both two things. Both to take decisions to do two things, to both get more information about what the world is like, and also to actually continue getting rewards while making this knowledge. So for this case, I will give you a simple, very simple actually problem. Let's say we have two possible actions, right? Action 0 and action 1. And we know, okay. Let's say that there are two possible actions, action 0 and action 1. So we know already, we have some prior knowledge, we call it CA, and we know that whenever we take action 0, we take the reward of 1, or we take the reward of theta. Okay? I think this is the pair action. The other thing is that we don't know what is the case when we do action 1. We either get the reward of 1, or we get the reward of minus 1. So, probability 2 we have two cases. Probability 2, we don't know what it's doing. The case, not the probability here is general belief. We believe that the probability 2, so what's true is that get the reward 1, and probability 1 minus 2, the reward minus 1. And write this like that. As soon as we have taken an action, then we can update our knowledge based on the new observation. So if we take action 0, actually we don't gain any knowledge because we just observe a reward of theta, and that's all. We already know what's the reward. If we take action 1, there are two cases. First of all, we may observe a 1, in which case the probability is changed like that. Or we might observe a minus 1, in this case the probability becomes. And the interesting thing is that you can write this as a nice little diagram where this is your initial belief and these are your subsequent beliefs. If you take action 0, then your belief never changes. If you take action 1, then your belief either becomes this one if you observe this
minus 1, or at least one filter plus 1 filter. So that's a nice compact way to express how your knowledge is changing according to your actions. And this works also for more complicated problems. So if you have more actions, an infinite set of rewards, and so on. And there is a procedure called backward induction, where, well, at least for some cases, so if you consider if it's not looped, if it doesn't have loops, like in this case, then you can use backward induction to find a relatively efficient solution. Otherwise, use something like value iteration from reinforcement learning, actually. So we will go back to this relation. Yeah.
After the first action you take.
First one, the action zero. Okay, if you take action zero, then you always observe what you already know is going to be true.
Then you take action one, and you move to one of these two beliefs.
Yeah, and there is no other thing because you know that the reward is deterministic in this case. So you okay. Just a very simple problem. It's either one or minus one, and you don't know what is the true.
Q is part of our belief.
Yeah, Q is their belief, and you don't know it's the real world, basically, and you have to discover it. Any other questions here? We have a lot of time.
Just on the graph, the reward should be minus one, like action
one. Ah, yeah, not zero, yeah, sorry, minus one. Okay. According to the previous slide.
Yeah. So,
okay, so we start with an initial belief, an actual CA. And if I take action zero, then my belief is summarized as this initially. Whenever I take action zero, the next reward will be theta. Whenever I take action one, I'm not sure what will happen. Probably Q, I think that what will happen is this, I will get a word one. But maybe there's another word that is actually the real word, which is this one. So if you write it like this, there are two possible words. One of them is action zero, get theta, and action one, you get one, and the other word is action zero, theta, and the other word is get function. So you don't know which one is true, and you just put some subjective probability on which one is true. And because this is the result of deterministic, as soon as you take action one, you will know which one is the reality. And now these states are not states of the words, they are states of your belief. And you start with the initial belief CA, and as soon as you perform action one, you gain more knowledge about what the reward of action one. And you update your belief about that. And these transitions basically represent how your belief changes depending on what action you take and what observation you make at the same time. So they depend. So if you look at the observations as both as a tuple of actions and rewards, then for every possible combination of action and reward, your belief updates in a different way.
So your beliefs are discrete.
In these cases.
Usually that's not what happens in reality.
No, in reality it's not what happens and it becomes more difficult. Very, very much difficult. I do not really want to look at this problem. I will skip this one, but and a very simple problem in reinforcement learning is you have many decisions and each decision gives a random reward which you don't know, and you get an expected, there's some expected reward from every possible action. And this is the general NRM value problem, and for these problems actually there is a solution for continuous belief, so you don't even know if the rewards are Gaussian. There is something called Gittings indexes which tell you what is the best action to take. But this is only for very specific distributions where you can analytically find the best function. Okay. Otherwise, you have to do a lot of approximations. So I'll go back again to what I was saying about summing over the rewards in time. I'll talk about reinforcement learning, basically. So reinforcement learning, a long time ago, around the same time that these guys started doing the optimal sequencing decisions, there were these guys that were saying, okay, we have this agent that is playing backgammon or chess or something like that, and he wants to maximize, yes? Yeah. And he wants to maximize his reward in the game of chess would be something like maximizing the probability that you win the game, for example. Or some other game would just gain accumulated rewards from this computer. But anyway, the problem is you have an agent that's acting in some environment that doesn't know everything about, or maybe he knows the exact state of the environment, but he does not know what will happen in the future, or what is the best way to act, and he wants to learn how to play by just observing one environment. He doesn't know what the best action every time, but he knows when he has lost the game, or when he doesn't want the game. So in this case, the reward would be something like this. You have some function G, you just go to 1, and all the rewards will be 0 all the time until you win the game when you get 1, or you lose the game when you get minus 1. So in that case, we would probably try in this case. So in this case, this expectation would be basically the probability that you win the game, more or less. A linear function. So how to choose actions in this case was formulated in the matter of a policy. So for every possible, for every problem, like, sorry, I cannot see my hand moving on the screen. So for every possible every problem like that, there's a policy which tells you how to choose actions. And every action and every problem like that gives you a utility of the policy. So this is exactly the same as previously we were talking about the utility of actions. Now we're talking about the utility of policies, which are sequences of actions, or rather methods of selecting actions sequentially. This can be just play action 1 now, action 2 later, action 5 later, or it can be something that depends on the data that you observe. What the adversary is doing, it can be anything. That's why I have this condition here. This condition on something, which I don't specify at the moment. It could be observations, it could be your belief, many different things. So in this framework, what is mostly done is talk about the Markov decision processes. And this Markov decision process basically has four things. It has states. So if you have a chessboard, then the state of the chessboard is your state, because you can observe it. And there are actions, which is, you know, what you can do is to move the rook in a particular point or the knight in another point, things of actions, usually. And then the transition distribution, given your current state and your action, move to another state. For chess, it's deterministic. Okay? The board changes in a deterministic manner. And then there's also rewards. Again, the deterministic for chess, and it depends usually on the states and actions. So.
Okay.
So what is bad capacity in this case? Is we consider them to be either known or unknown, and we try to find a policy that gives you the maximum expected reward. Okay. And it's proven that for any MVP, the policy that is optimal has the stationary policies are always optimal. So even if a non-stationary policy is optimal, also the stationary policy would be optimal too. So stationary policies are policies where the action that you take at any point in time only depends on the state, basically. One policy like that is the uniform policy. And another policy is the greedy policy, which puts some fixed estimates. So,
something different, and you know, if you play poker tournament,
So the question is, one of the cases is that MTP is known, there are already algorithms for that, by iteration. What people do when the MTP is unknown? Well, the problem is that if you have a belief about what is the real MTP, every time you make a new observation, your belief changes. So the stationary, the policy that is optimal according to your current estimates is going to probably change. And there are two ways of acting in this case. Just act according to this way, which I think is optimal, or try and just improve and play in such a way that you maximize observations where you don't know about your MTP. This always results in an unnecessary process. Even just taking but most of the time, the critical policy with the current estimates are different as to make new observations. And for example, for a planning problem, just playing about it whether there's one, and just fixing whenever you don't get the one, will be a non-dictionary policy, for example.
So, one of the questions in reinforcement learning is how to balance exploration and exploitation.
There are some ad hoc mixtures, like hex and greedy, or just starting with very initial estimates, and then as you make more observations about what is good, you realize that the optimistic estimates are not so actually true, and they drop, and then you try something else that you haven't tried before. This is okay, it works more or less, but for difficult problems, it does not. And the other problem is that, well, it maybe allows you to reach an optimal policy, but it does not try and accumulate as much reward as possible initially. Right. So some mathematicians actually try and minimize the loss while actually doing exploration. And so you actually give them what is your cost function and they really try to behave optimally. So if you have a short time horizon, for example, then they will just be more greedy, and if you have a long time horizon, they will try and find smart tools. So there are, for example, ECE TUC and UCB aggregate bounds are some well-known algorithms. This is for mostly for this is for any reinforcement learning model, and this is mostly for quantum problems. There are some extensions of that for the general problem, but they only work in the unit chain case at the moment. So as I said, this work UCB, for example, only works in the unit chain case of MTPs. And because of that, this is a severe restriction actually. You cannot really get any useful proofs otherwise, if your case is not simple. So the solution, decision theory, is just to take a look at all of the possible policies that start with a particular action, and for every possible word, and for this word, you look at what's the best possible policy following a particular action, and you look at the utility of that. And you do that for all possible words, integrating over all of them. And that gives you the utility of every action under uncertainty. The problem is there are so many words here, and there are so many words here, you can find what's the best action. Especially for infinite horizon, there's a problem. So what is one way to do that, actually? If you look at the problem that we had before with the simple problem, this one, and if you look at an MTP, actually if you aggregate together states of your model, the world and the state of your belief, you have a new MTP. And you can solve this with file iteration perhaps. The problem is that it's very big. Okay, so it's so big you can't really solve it. There are some ways to get around that. One way is to look ahead at some time t, and then your tree is not very deep, but it can still be very wide, because if you have infinite, if your belief space is infinite, then there's not much you can do about it. Another way is, okay, if your tree is going like this, normal, let's say. In a very easy case, you can pass up the direction, so exponential. And you have a lot of space at the end. As you've done much. The problem is how to not do all the calculations here. What you need to do is just look at these final points
can at least find this probability. And then you can assume that as soon as you take one action, you will somehow magically know what's the
reality.
And that will give you an optimistic estimate on the utility of exploration. So if anything in the case where you can gain complete knowledge after one step, you still don't get any gain over choosing the greedy action, then you should not do any exploration, you should perform the greedy action. And that's one way to do that, balance on the utility. And I worked a bit with that. It seems to work okay for bandit problems, but not for reinforcement learning in general. Another way is to prune this tree.
So if you have already good policy, then you can just take the actions that seem to be good things.
Don't explore so much on the other actions. I mean, so you have a dual exploration problem now. You move from exploring the actual MTP to exploring your tree of future beliefs. So, as I said before, for Gaussian rewards in bandit problems, you have hidden syntaxes which are okay to work with, but they don't extend to anything else at the moment. But perhaps there are some closer approximations that can be done. Okay. This is a simple graph I did some time ago on the street. Okay. So it was a problem where you have two actions. One action is always giving you 0.5, and the other one is random. It gives you either 1 or 0 probability, which you don't know. And the probabilities, the possible probabilities are 0.25 and 0.75. So in this problem, the maximum probability that you, the expected maximum reward that you can get over infinite number of random experiments is 0.625. And yeah.
So this would be the same problem. Here you have two methods, where you have two machines with two levers. So one lever gives you the least value of the same reward. What is it? 0.5. And the other one, you don't know. And another one gives you either, gives you a random reward with mean either 0.25 or 0.75.
Right. So every time you do it, you get a sample from
this distribution. From this distribution. And you're then you need to identify which one is the distribution, 0.25 or 0.75.
Right.
So if you run this experiment many times, it's time initializing the bandits, the unknown band with a different probability. And if your prior is match, in this case a match, you have the ability to go up to this maximum point. So I have here a lot of gears. One of them is epsilon greedy, and these two are epsilon greedy with two different amounts of acceleration. As you can see, even you have quite a lot of acceleration, it converts quite slowly to what you want. And if you put higher number than it will, so around here anyway, so you will never get your maximum reward. So you have to have some schedule. What schedule you use is not very clear. The other way to do it is to just use a belief MTP and expand it up to some time, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 here. And interesting thing is, it starts working after some point, that it starts working after a relatively small number of steps. So like 4 or 5. So after expanding your tree to 5 steps, then you reach the optimal performance quite quickly. And I actually did some experiments with the Apple of algorithm. You get somewhat similar performance to this. So the question is whether this can be expanded. I haven't done the work for that for over a year actually now, but now that I'm working with Kallis here, we want perhaps to use this in a full reinforcement learning problem. I just expand the belief tree completely up to a number of steps. Yeah, and then I do policy iteration and I get the best action.
And then you do backwards and action.
Yeah. And that's all for this.
So
when
we get to 3.5
we
expect to get the best results,
right?
That's
the
line.
Yeah.
When is the theory, is that the one?
Oh, it's just random fluctuation. I did, I think, only 100 experiments. It takes too long, far too long to do this.
Is this measured for
is 100.
Okay. But five steps, so at every time step, I look five steps ahead. So I expand it with five steps and I do the next action. Then, as soon as I get to the observation, I do a new tree. Yes. Okay. I don't know what is the method you could get. Something like that.
So, in theory, if you increase t, you will get even better?
Yeah, in theory, you get up to points, which is the maximum, and the theory says that if there is always some t for which the solution is the same as optimal for infinity. So, you should get the same result. After some point, you should stop improving. For this case, it seems to be quite small. For other problems, yeah.
So
the indices, have you ever used them actually?
Yeah, actually, yeah. I'm sorry, but I would be interested in checking how they compare. So this is for the indices, for the indices, for indices, but sometimes they might even apply for finite. So I was wondering whether this, how this compares. Okay.
This is for infinite. I'm not sure. This is going to be right for infinite.
Okay, so these are some related papers. So Peter Arora has a classical UCP algorithm for Newtonian bodies. It's very, very simple. And this is the book I'll talk about. This is a paper I wrote last year about how to shortcut this tree and make Newtonian decisions. This is very interesting for people that work on Bayesian method for reinforcement learning. They include the Gaussian prior over the returns for every state action for continuous problems actually. And this is the paper that wants to work with Michalis here. And basically uses simulation to expand to improve a policy. So you start with a policy and you do simulation to find how to improve this policy. And the simulation basically is based on the initial random generation of states, and then following this particular policy to try to improve it. So we want to work with two things. One is to make this tree searching in this algorithm more clever. And the other way to do is to use some policy we present in some compact way to set the tree in the exploration problem. So it's the complementary to the process. And the third thing that we want to try and do is replace the current simulation model with a belief over a number of models. That's all. Thank you very much for listening.
One way to use the part of the methods.
also this takes into account also the sound.
Take a single decision initially, just one decision.
Very simple. You just say, my experience in words.
I'm sorry.
So, let's say one decision, right? So, the experience in words at time zero. Experience in words zero. It's just, let's say, action A. We know that's theta. So this is the value. So what is the experience
just for action 0?
Action 0. Action 0. So the experience reward again, initially, if you take action 1, this probability is action 2, right? Q times 1 plus Q times minus 1. So now if this is larger than this, then you do action 0, otherwise you do action 1, you do 1 step. Okay. Now, let's do more steps. Okay. If you do actually take action 1, then this is your initial, don't change anything here. And then if you take action 1, you have two choices. You either take, again, action this one, so for action 0, you have two choices. Take action 0 again, or take this one. Okay. And somehow, well, both of them. Okay. And so what's the best thing to do if you have two actions? So you start, two steps. You start with action 0, and then you say, you write your two choices. And for your two choices again, you see which one is the best, and you keep this one. And this is basically the intrigue of taking action 0. So the world that you expect for now, plus the utility in the future, the maximum utility in the future given the order of the courses. And then for this, it should be the same. It could be, for example, that, so basically if it's large enough, Q, then compared to theta, then the horizon is large enough, then we have, so then we decide to choose action. That's the horizon. You have to expand. You have to consider all the possible choices.
So you work backwards?
Yeah, you can work backwards.
You find the best action at the last step?
Yeah, you can find either the best action in the last step, or you can just use this as an entity and solve by the question.
So at the moment, you decide based on the rewards. Science about how good a belief state is. I mean, maybe the belief state exceeding is more accurate of something of CC. I don't
know. You don't know anything, right? You don't, all of the beliefs are accurate. The beliefs are always getting more and more accurate, basically. As you go into it. But there's no reason that we make distinction between any of them. You could, if you want to look at us as an expanded tree, you could look at us as an expanded tree and then do backwards induction, but you could also just look at us as an expanded tree.
Yes.
συζητάμε, να καταλάβουμε τι σχέση έχει αυτό το ασέρι που αρχίζουμε και φτιάζουμε με κάποιο θείο που λέει ποσοτή θεωρή, τη Wild Trade. Το οποίο είναι ένα μπιβολέσιο, ένα σκιν που δίνει διαφορετικά όψους, ας πούμε, για ένα ρούι. Το οποίο, ας πούμε, το πώς ήταν πιο παλιά. Γιατί το ποσοτή τη θεωρή ουσιαστικά παραδείγματος ότι δεν υπάρχει ότι ας πούμε ένα κομμάτι ενός ρούι μπορεί να είναι ιονικού ρυθμού, αλλά και το possibility να είναι δωρικού. Και αυτά τα δύο possibilities μπορεί να είναι μεγαλύτερα από το ένα.
Δεν είναι probability.
Ναι, δεν είναι probability. Και αντιμετωπίζει και qualitative values, δηλαδή όχι μόνο numeric, γιατί οι αρχαιολόγοι χρησιμοποιούν πολλά διαφορετικά, ας πούμε, εκφράσεις για να...
Αυτό, possibility θεωρικά, το ξανακούσε η Ρίνα.
Είναι ένα extension του fuzzy logic,
από εκεί. Το fuzzy logic πρέπει να έχει.
Αλλά τώρα έχουμε αρχίσει να το κοιτάζουμε και μου αρέσει πολύ αυτό το logic, γιατί συνήθως όλα τα archaeological reconstruction στα γραφικά είναι εντελώς χαζά, ενώ τώρα υπάρχει ένα μαθηματικό μοντέλο.
Χρήστο, θα ευχαριστώ λίγα για την Κατερίνα Καυσινή και μαζί να δούμε κάποιο project το οποίο μπορεί να σε ενδιαφέρει, ξέρω. Visualization αρχαιολογικών χώρων.
Ναι, based on uncertainty.
Possibility theory.
Possibility theory.
Δηλαδή, λες, τώρα είναι έτσι, πώς μπορεί να ήταν κάποτε. Καταλάβεις. Possibility βάζεις.
Ναι, ναι, ναι. Το έχεις ακουστά ποτέ αυτό. Το έχεις διαβάσει.
Υπάρχουν από τους πολλούς τρόπους να κάνεις το uncertainty, αλλά περισσότερο υπορτιμούν τα πιθανότητα στα απλά, γιατί υπάρχει θεωρία.
Ναι, σαφώς. Απλά σε αυτή την περίπτωση το possibility αυτό που σου δίνει η διαπραγματικότητα τη πιθανότητα είναι λίγο να σου πει ότι ένα κομμάτι ένα possibility.
Τώρα να περπατάει με το κουμπί, το είπα πέρα μετά και το απλά να ήταν από για εσένα με περπατάει. Κατάφερε να περπατήσει κάποια φάση
αντιμετωπίζει και κρατούσε λίγο το καλό τη έννοια που παρέμει ο λόγο κάποιε ενδείξει. Αλλά σκέφτομαι.
Αυτός
είναι ένας φοιτητής που στην Αγγλία, που μόλις αρχίζει να το κοιτάζει με το πράγμα, δεν είναι καθηγητής, δεν έχει καμία σχέση με το machine learning.